This is Coding Math, episode 29, Tweening, part 1. Now, in the last couple of videos, we discussed the background and basics of easing and tweening and went into a bit of what I call simple easing, which is just moving an object some fraction of the distance between where it is and its target position. While simple easing is indeed simple and can be a great solution for many situations where something needs to ease into place, it does have its limitations. One of the most obvious limitations is that it's only an ease out. The object will slow down and smoothly glide into its ending position, but the motion will start out very fast. If you change the easing variable to make the object start out more slowly, it winds up moving way too slowly at the end. So this type of easing is best for moving things onto screen and into position, not so good for moving things off screen or from one position to another. Another limitation is that there's no way to specify exactly how long the motion will take. Again, you can mess with that ease value, but it can take a lot of trial and error since there's no actual time measurement being done, and the animation may wind up looking slightly different on different computers. Related to that last one is that there's no actual ending point for this kind of easing. It will just continue to run until you tell it to stop, getting closer and closer to the target. But even when it's just a millionth of a pixel away, it's still going to try to keep getting closer unless you put some code in there to evaluate the distance and tell it how close is close enough. Thus, this type of easing is great for one-off animations where you just need to move something into place. But when you get into a situation where you're trying to choreograph the motion of several objects at once, it might be time to look at a more full-featured tweening library. As I showed you in a previous video, there were tons of these libraries available for ActionScript in Flash. All of these were based around formulas developed by Robert Penner. Now, you'll find these same exact formulas in use in the core animation libraries in iOS, in OS X, and the object and value animator classes in Android. And for JavaScript, there's some of this functionality built into jQuery, and there are two JavaScript tweening libraries currently in the spotlight. Tween.js, which is part of the Create.js library. This was created by Grant Skinner, who had previously authored gTween in ActionScript. And the GreenSock animation platform, which also started out as an ActionScript tweening library. I'm honestly a bit surprised that more of these ActionScript libraries didn't get ported to JavaScript. Maybe after this series, you'll create the next popular one. So what are some of the benefits of using a tween library? First of all, you have the ability not only to ease out, but to ease in as well, or do both in the same tween. You can also specify different formulas for the easing, to make the easing stronger or more subtle. Some of these formulas even create springy or bouncy effects rather than just sliding the object into place. Then you have the ability to specify an exact time in seconds or milliseconds that you want the tween to take place in. The fact that a tween has a definite duration means that you know exactly when it has ended. In fact, most libraries will allow you to listen for a completion event or pass in a callback function that will be run when the tween is complete. Finally, piggybacking on top of the completion function, most tween libraries have powerful synchronization features, allowing you to do things like run multiple tweens in parallel or have a series of tweens that run one after another. Many often also provide a delay function, so you can have, for example, one object tweening into place at the same time another one is tweening out, and when those are done, some other element fades in, and after a half a second delay fades out again. All this is pretty easy to do in most of these packages. Now, rather than teach you how to use any of these libraries, I'm going to show you how they work. Ideally, at the end of all this, you'll be able to write your own tween library with all the features you need it to have. Make it powerful enough, release it, and become rich and famous. So again, all this comes back to the equations that Robert Penner wrote years ago for Flash. In fact, there was a rather amusing Twitter thread on this subject with someone complaining about how these equations were written and the fact that they're still in use everywhere. I'm sure the person didn't expect to have Robert reply personally. So let's look at some of these infamous formulas and see why they're resulting in near-death threats. Here's the original ActionScript version of Robert's easing functions. These are written in ActionScript 1, which is convenient for us since it's nearly identical to modern-day JavaScript syntax. Robert chose to add these functions to the math object, but we'll be creating them as standalone, separate functions for now, which you can later add to your own tweening library. Now first there's the linear tween, which, as you can see, means no easing. It just changes a property from a beginning value to an ending value over a certain amount of time. This is very similar to the behavior of the lerp function we created back in Coding Math Mini number 2, though the parameters are a bit different. Here we get T, B, C, and D, which are the current time of the tween, the beginning value, how much that value will change, and the duration of the tween. Now, if you look back to the lerp function, you see that we get a norm parameter, which is a normalized value between 0 and 1, and min and max values. Now, in the linear tween function, he's dividing T, current time, by D, total duration. Since current time will start out at 0 and increase up to that total duration, dividing these two will result in numbers ranging from 0 to 1. Thus, this is really the same as our norm parameter in lerp. The B, or beginning value, is the same as lerp's min parameter. And to get the change in value, we just subtract min from max. So you can see that despite the different strategies in what gets passed in, these functions are doing exactly the same thing. Now let's jump into some coding and see how you could use a function like this. I'll start with the usual animation template. I'll add a property for the start position and set that to 100-100. Then a target object and a change object. Those will be empty objects for now and get filled in when we decide where we want to go. We'll need a start time to measure how much time has transpired. This too will get set when we start the tween. And finally a duration, which I'll just set to 1000 milliseconds, or 1 second. Now I'll draw a circle at the start position. I'll do this by calling this function drawCircle. And down here I'll create that function. Simple enough. Now I don't actually want to start the update loop until I start the tween itself, so I'll remove this call to update and replace it with a click event handler. This will set the target x and y to the point on the screen that was just clicked. Then we'll subtract the start position from the target position and get a change value on each axis. This could have been done as separate variables, but since we're going with objects for everything else, change will be an object. Finally, we'll capture the start time and call update. Oh, and we'll want that event parameter in there so that we can get its client x and y, of course. Now in the update function is where we'll be doing the tweening, so we'll need a tweening function to call. I'll just copy in the linear tween function here. And I'll fix it up a bit so it's just a standalone function instead of a method of the math object. Now we go into the update function. This will be called over and over, as usual on any kind of animation program. First we'll get the elapsed time of the tween. This will be the current time, which we can get by creating a new date, minus the start time, which we saved at the start of the tween. Now there are two possibilities here. The current time could be less than the duration, or it could be equal or greater to the duration. If it's less than the duration, we want to calculate the current position based on the easing function. So in here we'll say x equals the result of this call to the linear tween function. We'll pass in the current time we just calculated, start x, change x, and the duration. And then we'll do the exact same thing for y using start y and change y. At this point, x and y will represent the current position of the object based on its starting position, target position, elapsed time, and duration of the tween. So we can draw a circle there. And since we're still tweening, we'll call request animation frame. Since this is the only time we want to continue the animation, I'll remove this later call to request animation frame. Now what if the time is equal to or greater than the duration? Well, we can just draw the circle at the target position and we're done. In here I'll change the start x and y to equal target x and y, so we'll use the current location as the start of the next tween when we click again. So let's see what this looks like. We click and the ball animates to an exact point that we clicked. Note that it takes exactly 1 second for each tween. This holds true whether I click far away from where the object currently is, or if I click right next to it. So the speed is not constant, but the time is. So that's what a linear tween is. As I discussed earlier, linear tweens are rather boring and not very lifelike, so let's try some others. I'll go into Robert's functions and copy easeInQuad, easeOutQuad, and easeInOutQuad, and paste them in here. And quickly clean them up in the same way that I did for the linear tween. Now all I need to do here is change the call to linear tween to easeInQuad for both x and y, and I'm doing a quadratic easeIn. Let's see what this looks like. Yep, it's starting out slowly and speeding up as it approaches the target. Let's try ease out quad. Cool, so now it's starting off quickly and slowing down as it approaches the endpoint. This is obviously very similar to the simple easing we did in the previous two episodes, but of course in this case you can specify the exact time that the tween will take. Finally, let's look at ease in out quad. Again, we just have to change the name of the function we're using for the tweening. Here the object starts slowly, gets up to full speed by the midpoint of the animation, and then begins slowing down as it eases into position. And despite all that complex speed changing, the tween will take almost exactly 1 second, or whatever the time you set for the duration. Now here the effect is pretty subtle, but I guarantee if you switch back and forth between ease in out and linear, you'll see how much better the version with easing looks. Now I'm not going to go through all the formulas here, that's for you to do, but basically all you need to do is copy them over from the original source file the same way I just did, and then change the function call. I'm sure you'll enjoy experimenting with these, and I know you'll have some fun with the more advanced formulas like elastic, back, and bounce. Also try different durations, and of course experiment applying the easing to properties other than XY position. Now in addition to this single source file, you should check out Robert Penner's site. He has a page dedicated to materials on the easing formulas. Here you can find a lot of his original source code, sources for easing formulas in a bunch of other languages, a link to download a chapter from his book where he describes all this stuff in much further detail than I possibly could in a few videos, as well as several other tools, articles, and videos. All you could possibly need to become a tweening ninja. Just make sure you read and follow the terms and use notices and give credit where it's due. Okay, so we've used a couple of these easing formulas and we've gotten an object to move using tweening, but there are a couple more subjects I want to cover in upcoming videos. First of all, you've seen how important the easing formulas themselves are. These are like the engine of a car, providing all the power of the tween. But in a car, you need steering and wheels and seats and a place to hold your coffee in addition to an engine. And you've seen that in order to utilize these easing functions, we had to write a fair bit of setup code to capture the start and end values, calculate the change, keep track of the time and which easing function to call, and figure out what to do with those return values. All those details are what makes tweening libraries useful. So in the next video, we'll look at how to abstract all of this stuff and begin to make your own tweening library that wraps around these formulas. I've also pretty much glossed over the mathy part of this whole subject, what's going on with the formulas themselves and how they actually work. So there'll be another video that covers that. But that's it for today, and you have a lot to experiment with, so see you next week.